to come to the podium and remind you to speak loudly and clearly into the microphone, because we have people listening on the telephone who will hear you best if you do that. And remember, after all the panelists have spoken, we'll proceed with questions. So, Dr. Ellis, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cushman, and thank you also to ASH for the opportunity to be here today at this press conference. And I'm very happy to share with you some of the slides that I'll be showing and some of the results that we have from our study. I'm from Israel, Tel Aviv University, and this study is entitled Bleeding in Patients with Atrial Fibrillation, which is a heart arrhythmia which makes people prone to blood clots, which can travel from their heart to particularly the brain and other areas of the body as well. And we're looking at treatment to prevent these events with warfarin, which, as has been mentioned, is a really old and tried and tested anticoagulant, in addition to two novel drugs, which are called novel oral anticoagulants. They're not so novel anymore. They've been around for a number of years, but we still refer to them as such, and we'll refer to them as NOACs by that abbreviation during the talk. And the two drugs that we studied were dabigatran and rivaroxaban. Those are the two NOACs. And as was mentioned, this is a population-based study, and I'll describe how we went about doing it. It's one of a few population-based studies that have been done, and our feeling was that this would give us some important information for treating our patients and for helping our colleagues who also have to deal with this problem, particularly in the fields of cardiology and neurology. So this is just an introductory slide which shows you over here the results of some randomized clinical trials that have been summarized in a systematic review or a meta-analysis. And this type of diagram is fairly simple to understand, where on the left of the solid line in the middle, if you have a square or a diamond, it means that the NOAC or the new drug is better than the old drug in terms of not causing bleeding. As has been mentioned, one of the big problems, if not the biggest problem, with using anticoagulants or blood thinners is that while they prevent blood clots, they also prevent normal blood clotting. And so people may suffer spontaneous or injury-induced bleeding, which can be devastating, particularly if it occurs in the brain. So these are four big studies that were done, and the composite result of all of these four studies implies that the novel oral anticoagulants are safer, or at least as safe as we see in these two studies over here, because they're very close to the solid line, as warfarin, which is very encouraging. Because on the efficacy side, how much they're able to prevent blood clots, which is not something that we studied in this particular work, they're as good as, and in some cases perhaps even better than warfarin. So if we have a drug that may be better and is equally safe, then perhaps that's a winner and that's what we should be using. However, when these drugs came to market, we soon began to see a number of reports, both in the medical and in the lay press, which implied that there may be some more bleeding associated with these particular new agents, the NOACs, than we were aware of or we were seeing in the randomized clinical trials that were performed. And the FDA, in fact, performed safety analysis of this, which has recently been published in a medical journal. Until the last few weeks, it had not been published. And about 5 or 6 months ago, there were a number of articles published in the British Medical Journal, which was somewhat provocative in that there was an implication that perhaps there were things that we didn't know about the results of the randomized clinical trials that had been performed, in particular regarding dabigatran, that would have helped us improve patient safety. So as practicing physicians, and I'm a practicing hematologist, these kind of reports made us a little bit wary and uneasy, and certainly our colleagues and our patients as well, who were exposed to this kind of information, started to wonder whether these NOACs were really the best drug for them to be on, in particular because of the risk of bleeding. So with that in mind, we set out to perform a study which had the primary aim of determining the rate of major bleeding, and by major bleeding, we referred to patients that bled and as a result thereof were hospitalized. Major bleeding is defined differently in different studies, but that's what we used as a real-world definition. We considered that if somebody bled and ended up being hospitalized, irrespective of the type or site of the bleed in their body, that was a major event, and so we counted that. And we looked at this in patients with atrial fibrillation, that's the AF on the study, who were beginning anticoagulant therapy. These were people who were either newly diagnosed or being treated for the first time with an anticoagulant. They'd never been exposed to anticoagulants before. Our secondary aims of the study were to see where the bleeding occurred. Obviously, the bleeding that is most worrisome and can, in fact, be devastating is bleeding in the brain. So we wanted to see if that mirrored the sites of bleeding that we saw in the randomized clinical trials. We also wanted to see if patients who had these sometimes devastating bleeds died more if they were treated with one or another of the drugs. And in order to do this, we used a database which belongs to the Clalit Health Services, which is the largest public health service provider in Israel. It has 4.5 million members, about 5,000 community clinics or community physicians in practice, and 14 hospitals. And we used this as a resource in order to find patients who had been treated with these anticoagulants for atrial fibrillation. The database that we used is fully computerized, and it links the international classification of disease diagnoses with pharmacy information, with laboratory information, and with hospitalizations. So we were able to get integrated information about all of these patients. The first thing I'd like to show you on this picture over here, going from left to right, is January 2011 to December 2013, which was the study period, which we chose because in January 2011, dabigatran was licensed for use in Israel. January 2012, rivaroxaban was licensed. So you can see in the blue bars over here, warfarin or Coumadin, and you can see how that decreases over time, taken over by the red bars, which is dabigatran, and then the yellow bars, which is rivaroxaban on top. So we can see that there's a tremendously quick uptake. So that by the end of our study period, the end of 2013, more than 50% of people starting anticoagulants for atrial fibrillation would be on one of the new anticoagulant drugs. We were able to identify a total of 18,249 patients with atrial fibrillation who started anticoagulation. These were unselected patients, which is different to what you see in randomized clinical trials. So they were all comers. Every consecutive patient with atrial fibrillation was studied. Of these patients, 9,554 received warfarin. We divided the dabigatran into two groups because in Israel both of these doses are licensed for prevention of stroke and atrial fibrillation, unlike the United States. So there's a 150 milligram dose which is given twice a day and a 110 milligram dose given twice a day, and rivaroxaban which is given in a standard dose, and you can see the thousands of patients that were treated over here. In order to account for the different periods of time that patients may have been on treatment, this is another difference in population studies compared to randomized studies, we corrected all these numbers to patient years of studies, of drug administration, to normalize for this difference in study in drug administration duration, and you can see here the number of patient years. Underneath that, we can see the age of the patients. We can see the percentage of patients who are women. That's important in atrial fibrillation. There's a difference between men and women in their stroke risk. The CHAD score, this is an abbreviation for congestive heart failure, hypertension, diabetes and previous stroke. This is a score that's used for deciding how likely it is that a patient with atrial fibrillation will develop a stroke or a clot. These numbers are very high compared to the randomized clinical trials, which is another thing we wanted to note. And finally, anti-aggregant or platelet use in these patients was very frequent as well. This is something that we're starting to recognize as a potential problem. So this is the main result of our study, which I want to share with you here in a table form. And we've calculated over here the major bleeding risk per 100 patient years. This is just a way of correcting for that difference in duration of therapy between the different groups. And the number over here in the large font is really the number to focus on. The numbers in parentheses here are what are called confidence intervals, which is an important statistical test to do. But you can see over here that the rate was 3.96 per 100 patient years for warfarin, and there was a difference between the two doses of dabigatran. One appeared to have a lower incidence of bleeding, which is actually the higher dose of drug, and one had a higher incidence of bleeding or rate of bleeding compared to warfarin, which is the lower dose of drug, slightly counterintuitive, and then rivaroxaban had about the same as warfarin. These numbers over here are what are called hazard ratios, and this sort of measures how much more dangerous or safe it is to be on one compound or another. And so we're comparing over here the hazard ratio of warfarin to dabigatran, 150 milligrams, and it's about 1.44 more times more dangerous to be on warfarin than on dabigatran. However, these numbers over here are important because they mean that really if you analyze this statistically in a very strict manner, there is no difference because of these what are called 95% confidence intervals. So in the best case scenario, we have equivalence in terms of bleeding risk between warfarin and dabigatran 150. The same is to be said about 110 milligrams, again, because of these confidence intervals, but the direction is different. You can see that the first number is above unity and the second number is below unity. This means that in actual fact, it appeared that it was almost safer to be on the higher dose of dabigatran than on warfarin, and it was almost more dangerous to be on the lower dose of dabigatran than warfarin. And the almost over here is because of the statistical phenomenon, and rivaroxaban was pretty much the same. So this was an unexpected finding, and we have to try and explain this. And just to summarize, and we'll try and explain that, the main result over here is that, in fact, our study is consistent with those randomized clinical trials that I showed you at the beginning. In terms of the rates of overall bleeding, what I didn't have time to show this morning is that, in fact, the organs in which bleeding occurred, particularly the gastrointestinal tract and the brain, were in the same direction, the same pattern that we saw in the randomized clinical trials. So the novel anticoagulants were safer in our study in terms of intracranial hemorrhage, which is a really serious hemorrhage, and slightly more dangerous in terms of gastrointestinal hemorrhage, which mirrors the findings of the randomized clinical trials. I haven't had time to discuss fully the case fatality rates, but just in a word, it didn't really make a difference if you bled while you were on warfarin or one of the novel anticoagulants. The rate in terms of comparing this to the randomized clinical trials, there was no difference between those drugs and bleeding. And another interesting finding that we would like to report from the study is that, in an unselected population, there's a tremendously rapid uptake of these novel anticoagulants, proving how popular they are among physicians who are prescribing these drugs for our patients. And so we feel that this might be of some assistance in assessing risk for patients who are on these trials. So in order to explain this apparent unusual finding of the higher dose being safer than the lower dose, our theory is that this is to do with selecting patients. We have data to show that the patients who received the lower dose were a priori at a higher risk of bleeding. So the message here is that physicians seem to be able to identify patients who are not at a high risk of bleeding. They don't have a bad bleeding risk profile, and they give them the 150 milligram dose, and that's good because it works well and doesn't cause bleeding. Whereas the 110 milligram group tend to be older, sicker patients, still as safe as warfarin, but perhaps there's room for caution over there when you consider prescribing that dose for patients with atrial fibrillation.